imagination and your power to observe life around you. Those of us at Disney Studios gave a lot and learned a lot as the art of animation grew. In this show, we'll explore some of the secrets of the illusion of life in the wonderful world of animation fascination.
Salagadoola, Metricaboola, Bibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo. Put them together and what have you got? Bibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo. Salagadoola, Metricaboola, Bibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo. It'll do magic, believe it or not. Bibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo. Now Salagadoola means a Metricaboola-Roo. But the thing about that does the job is Bibbidi-Bobbidi-Boo.
I'm Frank Thomas. I worked at Walt Disney Studios from 1934 to 1978. That makes about 43 years.
And I'm Ollie Johnston, and I started in 1935 and worked till 1978. And that also makes 43 years.
Any way you figure it. I started on some of the shorts, did some Donald Ducks, Mickey's, Pluto's. Then when we started Snow White, I worked on the dwarfs, Pinocchio, the character himself, Bambi. We had Thumper and Bambi and some of the other little animals. Then Cinderella did Stepmother. Peter Pan did Captain Hook, Lady and the Tramp did all the dogs, Sleeping Beauty, Three Good Fairies, Ollie and I did those together.
Mistress Flora, Mistress Fauna, and Mistress Merriweather.
Well, the first picture I animated on was Mickey and the Brave Little Tailor, and I worked on Pinocchio. And Peter Pan, I did Mr. Smee. And Alice in Wonderland, I worked on Alice and the Little King. Jungle Book, I did Baloo and the Boy and the Panther. And Rescuers, I did Captain Orville and the Mice and the Little Girl and Rufus the Cat, who looks like me.
Cartoons were based on the comic strips of the period, and there were many graphic devices that were used that the people had learned to recognize, accepted them. If someone was looking at something, there were dotted lines go out. If someone had an idea, a light bulb went on above their head. Very cute things. They're all gimmicks, however, and they would amuse an audience, but they wouldn't sustain the picture. But in the mid-30s, under Walt Disney's influence, animation exploded. The appeal of the Disney films, which attracted me, was the new type of film they were doing where there was more personality in the characters.
Personality characterizations came from Walt himself. And I think it came from Walt acting out these characters for the animators.
He wouldn't get up and act like you're on the stage. He wouldn't say, hey, fellas, this is where I want to see this scene. He would just spontaneously become the character as he talked about it. Walt was always working that way. One story man, Ralph Wright, had a funny story. When he first went to the studio, the first assignment he was given was to do Pluto waking up. And he'd never met Walt before, so he was in this meeting with Walt, and the main story man was going through the story, showing all the work. When he got through, Ralph was apprehensive. Well, Walt liked my stuff. And no sound, so he turns around like this to see, and here's Walt back there going, twisting his face all around, you know, and Ralph thinks, oh my golly, he's a spastic of some kind. He's like these insane kings of England that they don't tell you about. There must be something wrong with him, no one told me. But at that point, Walt said, you know, The guy first wakes up, he sort of scrunches his face around and has this awful taste in his mouth. He says, maybe we get Pluto, you know. When he wakes up, he's got one eye open. He was just acting out the part of Pluto. Gave Ralph an awful scare.
Playful Pluto was a real milestone for the studio because in that picture, Norm Ferguson actually made the character seem to be thinking about the predicament he was in. He would try to wrestle his way out of the flypaper, you know, he was all tangled up in the thing. And then he would stop and sit down. His expression would go from a wide eye to a frown or whatever. But it changed expression, which is the thing that shows the thought process.
At that time, our acting, see, we were just beginning to get into acting, and we were pretty crude with it. We needed broad, simple things to draw. You couldn't draw subtle things on the face of Mickey, for instance. You had to have big things, eyes open, eyes closed, one eyebrow up, look a sneaky look out to the side. You couldn't do subtle acting with it. So we were fortunate in having, at that time, they were just coming out of the movies from the earlier period of a very broad acting. And we could study that and see, well, they went too broad, but maybe on a cartoon character it would work. So we got our beginning in that broad school of acting, which was very important to us.
Walt encouraged us to study animals, to study people, anything that we might use. For instance, on Bambi, he hired one of the best teachers to instruct us in animal anatomy, and he had a deer that we drew from, and everything that was necessary for us to study was made available. And live actors, almost everything that Alice did was photographed. It's not that we couldn't animate it, but it was much easier to do it if you had this live action to work with you. Any unusual perspective?
No. Oh, no, no, not again.
Oh, Mary Ann! Now you see him, Mary Ann.
He changed size in the film, and it was very important to get the change in perspective. So she was shot up on top of something so we could get the drawing that way. She had to have the scale just perfect for everything around her. Same thing was done on Cinderella. Shot the whole picture in live action. So we had everything we needed to study.
You wouldn't want to trace the photostats or the trace from the film directly because it always made the figure look very strange. You see that occasionally on commercials, or some of the other studios have done quite a bit of what you call rotoscoping, which is tracing exactly. It never has the life. It never looks like it fits into the background, into the setting. What you have to do is caricature what the real animal, what the real person is doing. The principle of squashing and stretching is a caricature of what happens in real life. You're not aware of it, you don't really see it until you study something frame by frame on film. And then you'll find that in the any bit of human flesh, it seems to bulge when it goes down low, when there's pressure on it. When you come up, it gets thinner. And that caricatured is the essence of what gives the free movement, the life, in the animated figure rather than just a stiff action. The personality that you give the character is so important because it's the only communication you have with the audience. They immediately see something that they've experienced themselves, or they say, that's just like Uncle Harry, or they say, I was like that when I was a boy, you know. And it's something they can identify with.
All this comes from observing and watching and noticing what goes on around you, because that's how you pick up this reservoir of ideas. An animator has to be very sensitive to those things.
We never thought it would last so long. We thought each week is the last week we'll be doing this. It's a nice job, but it sure isn't going to last. And particularly, we felt that Walt was going way out with some of his ideas of what ought to be in a cartoon. And particularly when he said he's going to do a feature cartoon. That was it. We knew we'd be, the studio would fold. I thought, nobody's going to sit still for a cartoon feature. That's going to be hard on their eyes. It's going to take too long. I don't know how he's going to do it, but he had us all come back to the night to the soundstage, and he told the whole story of Snow White, how he was going to do it. And that convinced us that there was enough entertainment there, there was enough believable characters, that it was it had rich values in it, that maybe it would go over. But we didn't see how he'd ever get the money.
It was referred to as Disney's folly, and I believe even Time magazine quoted some Hollywood people as having said that. And they thought, well, how can anybody put a million or a million and a half into a cartoon where the lines wiggle all over the place?
We were all very nervous towards the end of the production because Walt had gone so heavily in debt on this, borrowed on his life insurance. Everything he had was in there, and he couldn't even meet the payroll in some instances at the very end. And it was important to everybody that this picture go over. We had no idea if it would or wouldn't. But I think that's why Walt put the dedication in there of his gratitude to his staff that had worked so hard to make this picture come off.
For the last whatever it was, 6 months or so, we worked from about 7 in the morning till 10 at night, with breaks for lunch and dinner, of course, in order to finish the picture up on schedule. And we were excited about doing it, really, even though, of course, we were concerned, but we wanted this picture to go because we could see it was the beginning of something big if it did go. And hopefully, Walt would make another one. We'd have a job. But no one complained about working. It was very strenuous.
But we were young.
And we had hair.
We were very surprised at the premiere showing that the audience gave such a warm response to it, total acceptance, and just overwhelmed by it. And we thought it was good, but this really put us on cloud nine.
Don't worry. I'll be all right. See you tonight.
Yes. Well, come on, man.
There were great character relationships of a type we'd never had before, like between the dwarves and Snow White. Like Dopey was like he was in love with his kindergarten teacher or something like that. And Doc was like a nervous teenager on his first date. And the concept of Grumpy, which is really complex, this guy just can't bring himself to like her. He's real defiant all through the picture, and then after she kisses him, it really gets to him, and he melts as he walks away, and that was a very complex concept.
The personality that you give the character is so important because it's the only communication you have with the audience. They immediately see something that they've experienced themselves, or they say, that's just like Uncle Harry, or they say, I was like that when I was a boy, you know. And it's something they can identify with.
All this comes from observing and watching and noticing what goes on around you, because that's how you pick up this reservoir of ideas. An animator has to be very sensitive to those things.
Lots of times you have great difficulty in finding a character, finding just the right personality for the character, and you look every place that you go I played in the band, the jazz band we had at the studio, the Firehouse 5 Plus 2. I was a piano player, and this was a great source of characters, because as being in the band, you're supposed to sit up there and smile at the audience. And, you know, you have to have contact with them. And so I'd watch all these people dancing by, and I'd say, you'd make a great horse, and you're a good pig over there, and, oh, that one, she's a squirrel. Look at that. And I remember one character I had a lot of trouble getting hold of was the Queen of Hearts in Alice in Wonderland. And I couldn't figure out how to portray her. So one night where the band was playing, I noticed a woman sitting over there who I'd seen around town before. She was well known in Hollywood, and she combined all the traits that the Queen of Hearts ought to have. She was a real, I say, pig. She was, you know, just no style, no grace or anything to her, and yet she was completely autocratic. And when she gave an order, she expected things to be done, but her self-image, and this I think was the important thing, was of a little girl, little bright-eyed girl, and she had not matured inside, and I thought those are the things you combine for the Queen of Hearts.
Who's been painting my roses red? Who's been painting my roses red? Who dares to taint with vulgar paint the royal flower bed? Of painting my roses red, someone will lose his head.
Oh no, your majesty, please, it's all his fault.
Not me, your grace, the ace.
You?
No, don't.
The goose, you say?
Not me, the tray.
Yes, enough. Off with their heads.
By finding a character, I was able to combine all those things I never would have thought of by myself. You have to get help observing around.
The most important thing we learned about observation from Walt Disney was to notice everything of interest around you. How people move, how they sit, how they stand, how an animal walks, how it acts when it's going to be fed, how it acts when it's mad, how anybody in your family acts when they're upset. Watch all the different moods and emotions that people have.
You would also observe the funny situations that developed. Because things are funny because of the people that are involved in them. And things happen that you, if you're involved, you don't think it's funny at all, but someone observing from outside, you know, will double up at it. And lots of times, something that happened to you will be funny 6 months later on, a year later on. You remember all of these things, because you never know when they'll affect what you might do with the character.
You know, we used to, at night when we'd leave the studio, or on a weekend, we'd watch for these things. And because we wanted to top everybody at the studio when we'd come back to work the next day or on Monday and have a better story than anybody else. So you'd exaggerate what happened, but of course there was a basis for it.
We retired in 1978 in order to write a book about the studio because we felt that the animation that had been developed there was unique and was possibly not going to be understood are done by future generations. So we wrote this book, as a matter of fact, heavy.
7.5 pounds.
About the work that was done at the studio, how that came about, what gave the illusion of life, which was a distinctive thing about the Disney product.
Actually, one of the biggest things that made that studio was teamwork, and Walt insisted on it. Once one guy did something that was good, he called everybody in and made them aware of it and told them to go see that guy and see what he was doing. We'd always act out for each other and get inspiration from each other, take our drawings in and flip them. The guy'd say, no, that stinks. I can't even tell what he's doing. So then you'd get mad at him, but you'd go back to your room and think about it and figure out, well, maybe he was right. By golly, I can't tell what he's doing either.
Well, this is a good example.
Since our retirement in 1978, one of the things we really enjoy doing is working with the young animators, talking with them about problems we all share and about new ideas. Today, we're working with a terrific group of students from Roland High School and from California Institute of the Arts. We also have a couple of young animators from the Walt Disney Studio. Today, we'll be talking about observation and why that's so important in creating an animated film. Here's something I observed. A 14-year-old boy is just starting to grow, and a friend of ours who's pretty short, hadn't seen him for some time, and she said, "My, how you've grown," which wasn't so unusual, but when they wanted to get back to back to see how tall they were, then something very unusual happened. So I started making a drawing of it real quick, you know, and they said, "What are you laughing at?" And I said, "You'll never know."
The thing you ought to do when you see something funny is to make a little sketch of it or write it down on a piece of paper so you keep a record of these things. And when you go to animate something and you want some idea for a personality, well, you'd be surprised how it'll fit in.
The important thing to get is the personality, because without personality, you don't really have a character. He's very bland. And anything you try to animate comes off very bland. But as soon as you get, well, I'll make a demonstration here. Say I have a bill here for $10,000 I'm going to give to Ollie. And this is without any personality. See? Real interesting, huh?
About all the right. Tallest thing you've ever seen.
All right, now say I'm a... Let's make me a character. Let's say that I'm an old Shylock, an old skinflint, you know. And I'm hunched down here, and I don't stand up. My knees are bent, and I keep my elbows in close because I want to hang on to everything I've got. I don't want anybody to take anything away from me. And when I walk, I sort of sidle up to him because I don't face things head on. And I kind of cock my head and squint, you know. Is that good enough for character for a start? Face, I come along here.
Well, I can't pay this. I'll lose my home, my car, my family. Haven't you any compassion?
Oh. Now, that starts to become more interesting, I hope. But say we give Ollie a different personality now. I'll still be the same guy coming
over there. He's the same guy. That's very important.
This will be what difference you'd get from a change of character relationship. So here I am again. I'm the mean guy.
$10,000? Why, you crook. If I hear another word out of you about this, boy, you are in trouble. I'll sue you.
So it makes a difference whether you're, what your personalities are and how they work together. And it's important to get that personality and the personality relationship. And you can find that in observation again.
Yeah, when I was starting on the albatross, I had no idea that I would find a personality in this nature footage. There was marvelous stuff that the studio had on albatross, but ordinarily you look at something like that just to get the design of the character or how the bird moves, how wings work and things like that. But out of this came a real personality, and the thing was that this bird was just atrocious at taking off and landing, which are the two most important things in flying. From that, we got the personality of the guy. And ordinarily, you wouldn't find that in a piece of live action footage like that. So you have to be alert for that.
This is your captain speaking. Welcome aboard, folks. Fasten your seat belts. No smoking, just sit back and leave the driving to me. And here we go!
I sure wish we'd have taken the train.
About 40 years, I sat in the same room, looking out the same window, and watched out on Mickey Mouse Drive or Dopey Drive, and I'd see all these people coming to work. And so I began to watch and see how they walked. And each guy has a different way of walking, so I kind of memorized four of these. And the first guy rode a motorcycle to work, and he always walked like he was going into a wind, and he'd go along like this. Then the second guy was a real skinny guy with real thin legs, and he worked in the layout department, and he always walked like he was sitting down. Then the next guy always walked like he never went down. He always just seemed to go up. He'd go up like this. Then there were two animators that would take their break at the same time every morning. About 6 minutes past 10, they'd come past my window. And they walked with no up and down, and they walked like they were well-oiled, and they would come along like this. Two of them right together. So you can observe those things and use them in your work. And somebody here, I think, said they maybe had a funny walk. Joe, didn't you have a...
Well, there's a guy at work that sort of has a... He's a sort of a real stiff guy, and he always has his arms down the side like this, and just...
Does he have a cigar?
No, he just picks at his lip a lot.
That's a good trait.
We always tried to have some acting or some emotion that was being expressed. Mowgli was very blue when he parted with the panther. And at first I wondered whether, well, should we show this through facial expressions and get in on close-ups of the character? But finally decided the best thing to do was to pick boyish attitudes, doing things that a kid would do when he's kind of despondent. He isn't ready to cry, but he doesn't quite know what he's going to do next. He's kind of lost the guy he thought was his friend. And there wasn't one place there where you really knew what the expression was, and yet you felt what he was doing.
That was great, and anyone at home with an 8mm camera could do the same thing, couldn't they?
Well, what if you don't have an 8mm camera? Then what would you do?
How about making some twirlies?
Hey!
Take a couple of pieces of cardboard and make drawings on each side of them. Put slots in them so they'll fit together. Like so. Take a little dowel that you put slots in the end here and put them in, and now give it a twirl. See what you have. They seem to animate as you spin them.
Yeah, that's great. There's old Donald hopping up and down in his mad tantrum.
Here's another one. He gets hit in the face with a pie.
He deserves that.
Then here's one.
Here's Mickey ready for the Olympic Games.
Anybody can make these. They're, they're very simple, and they give the principles of animation. Then there's also the flip books. Here's a fellow skipping rope, I believe.
Take any pad
that has at least 25 pages in it.
And just take a simple little stick figure, and you can have a lot of fun with it. Make them do anything you want.
Here's another stick figure, a guy coming in and jumping. You're going to dive. Here he goes. But the board's too much for him. Here's a hippo.
Oh, my gosh. This guy's really gone all out.
I think that's a ballerina hippo. And over here's a drawing in another way with a bunch of circles. This fellow's bowling, and he's drawn very simply. Anyone could do this. Getting ready to throw the ball, and here it comes. He slips, the ball goes up in the air and right into the camera. Kapow. We've been asking you a lot of questions. It's only fair now. Any questions you want to ask us?
What would you guys consider your biggest challenge as it came to working out a character over the years that you were animating?
It's hard to pick one that was the most challenging, but one of the most interesting challenges we ever had was in the Wizard's Duel in Sword in the Stone. The big problem there was to maintain your character, your personalities, even though they changed shape and changed identity. I have some cells here of Madam Mim and Merlin, and they're going out in the wizard's duel. The idea is that they try to change themselves into something that can destroy the other. And one of them changes into a crocodile, she does, and he changes into a turtle. And then they keep changing and keep changing. Well, each time they change, you must not lose your character. There must not be any confusion as to who is Mim and who is Merlin. So the things we did was to keep Merlin's glasses and his mustache, gave up his beard. But in each one of the drawings, when he's a little caterpillar here, he still has a mustache and the glasses. Here, when he's a crab, he has the mustache and the glasses. We kept the color throughout. She had purple hair, which we kept everywhere. Merlin kept the blue, even though he was a turtle. But the biggest thing that we kept was the personality. Even though he's a turtle or a crab or whatever it is, Merlin was very stuffy, while she is completely mad and zany and giggly and gushy and unpredictable. And by keeping those personalities, regardless of what shape they take, I think the audience was led through this real interesting story situation without ever becoming confused. You ought to take a look at it and see if we succeeded.
Rule one, no mineral or vegetable, only animal. Rule two, no make-believe things like pink dragons and stuff. Now, rule three, no disappearing.
Rule four, no cheating.
All right, now pace off 10. One, two, three, four.
Ma'am, now you made the rules.
Oh, go!
Here now, madam.